All right. Good evening, everyone. It is a joy to be meeting with you again this evening. We have had a couple sessions, most of us together, but if you don't know me, my name is Meg Patterson. I'm a minister in Ottawa, and I'm delighted to be your host over this conference. Tonight, we have a special treat because we are joined by a number of guests, in addition to Norman Wirzba, who all come from different fields, and they're all, I would say, experts in their fields. And we're going to have a chance to hear their perspectives on climate change and on how their industry and how their work is impacting our fight with the climate crisis. So just, again, a couple of reminders as we get started. Please keep yourself muted unless you're speaking. There will be time at the end for question and answer, but the way the evening is going to go, we have some a music video to start and then a video welcome, and then I'll turn it over to our moderator and to our panelists, and they're going to introduce each other or themselves, and then they're going to have a discussion between themselves, and then there'll be time for question and answer at the end. There'll be lots of time for that, so don't worry. You can write your questions down, you can send them in the chat, and we'll deal with them when we get to the Q&A. All right, so with no further ado, I will invite James to share our videos. Thank you.
Good evening, friends, and I welcome you again to the conference Climate Change, What Can I Do? Hosted by the Synod of Quebec and Eastern Ontario of the Presbyterian Church in Canada. Some issues seem so enormous, we don't know where to begin in order to confront them. In our complicated world, what can any of us as individuals do about global hunger, militarism, out-of-control capitalism, reconciliation with Indigenous peoples? We encounter countless news items describing the challenges facing humanity but feel helpless to do anything about them. And so we tend to live in guilt, which has been defined as unresolved sin. We know we live in a society that acts in destructive ways, that we are part of that society and act as individuals in destructive ways, but we don't know what to do to bring about the changes that are so desperately needed. Our current climate crisis is certainly one of those issues. Every day we hear more news about the rise of global temperatures and the kinds of destruction that this is causing. And yet there's a disconnect in our minds between our own lifestyles, the cars we drive, the homes we heat, the food we eat, the consumer goods we buy, and the increasing numbers of hurricanes, droughts, and floods, glaciers that are melting and ocean levels that are rising. Solutions will need to be found both through actions of our governments and also through our own individual choices. The Apostle Paul spoke of the church as the body of Christ, where each part has a part to play in the whole, and that only when all act together is Christ honored and the body able to fulfill its high calling. Paul could have equally used the metaphor of creation, because we continue to learn how every part of creation has a function within the whole. The creation is symbiotic, where each piece both supports the other parts and in turn is fed by them. No part acts alone. Humanity is one part that depends on all of the other parts. This conference intends to give us some tools to overcome our information paralysis and to act in ways that respect, honor, and care for God's good creation. Let us not settle for wallowing in guilt when God is calling us to turn around and live differently. And perhaps we begin at the beginning with those very first words that we find in the book of Genesis. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God created, not us, but God, who is the author of all things that exist. And God isn't apart from creation, but indeed is embodied in it. Let us begin with a word of prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and Holy One, in Jesus Christ, we know the depth of your love for your world and the lengths to which you will go in order to live out that love. As we gather to listen and learn this evening, we pray that any defensiveness dissolves, that we come with eagerness and curiosity and in recognition that we need to die to old ways of living if we are to be raised to new ways. Teach us how to love the world as you do, and to see ourselves as part of your creation, not its owners. May we be led to overcome our senses of help of hopelessness and be led by your Spirit, inspired to live differently. We pray these things through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. It is now my pleasure to introduce to you our town hall panel moderator, the Honourable Thomas Mulcair. Tom is visiting professor in the political science department at l'Université de Montréal. He's a lawyer who holds degrees in French civil law as well as common law from McGill University. He was elected 3 times to the Quebec National Assembly and was the author of Quebec's landmark Sustainable Development Act when he served as Minister of Sustainable Development, Environment and Parks. He was elected 4 times to the House of Commons and served as party leader and leader of the official opposition. You may know Tom as a political commentator on the CTV network as well as on the radio station CJAD here in Montreal. Please join me in welcoming Thomas Mulcair.
Thanks a lot, Ian, for those very kind words and your very inspiring view that you shared with us so generously about respecting God's creation. And I think that that is one of the elements that we're going to try to keep in mind tonight as we listen to our panel, comprised of people from various points of view, and try to keep that in mind, what that Christian view on climate change means as we're trying to answer a simple question: what can I do? So our town hall panel will look at this from 3 different realms, from science, from ecology, and from politics, and ask that very question: what can I do? And our hope tonight is that when we bring all that together, people will have a better understanding of the scientific underpinnings of climate change and its reality, but also the religious aspects that can help people feel inspired to action. So let me give you a little bit of an understanding of how we're going to proceed, and it's to complete what Meg was saying right at the beginning. So what's going to happen is I'm going to introduce a series of panelists, and I'll give a brief CV for them. They'll take a few minutes to expose their point of view, and then that panel together will have our own question and answer period to try to make it lively and to try to bring out some of the ideas that they've expressed and prepare for the part that I always love the most, which is the Q&A with you, the wider audience who are there today. So when the floor opens to you for questions and comments, simply raise your hand in the reactions tab on your Zoom controls. We've all gotten so used to this in the past year. I think most of us can follow that. And our production staff will then put you up on screen. And if that's too intimidating, you prefer to do it another way, you can just submit your written questions on the Zoom chat box to Meg Patterson, that you just met at the beginning. She's in the control booth and she's going to read them out to us. So without further ado, I want you to meet someone who's got extraordinary ability to talk about this. Dr. Norman Wirzba is a Canadian theologian, but he teaches at Duke University, where he is tonight. Dr. Wirzba, what is the message that you've been sharing with delegates to the convention this weekend?
Yeah, thank you so much, Tom. I thought that I would take some time to talk briefly about why it isn't enough for us to talk, when we talk about climate change, to keep the focus on things like CO2 emissions, methane release, ocean expansion, sea level rise. These are all terribly important matters for us to be thinking about. We clearly need to be thinking about technological development. We need to be thinking about creation of new energy grids. These are all really, really important. But what I want to draw our attention to above all is that things like climate change, or perhaps we should better call them climate catastrophe, since climate change is a rather neutral designation, we need to be thinking about what are the fundamental issues at play that are bringing about the kinds of realities that we have to be so concerned about. Things like sea level rise, things like a warming planet. And so what I want us to do is to think just briefly about not just the ethics of what people might be doing, but even more deeply than that, what I call the ontology of our world. Now, that's a very abstract way of speaking, but I'll make it very direct. To speak about the ontology of our world is to ask, what kind of world are we in? And I think what is very clear from the way our economy, the way our governments, in many instances, the way our businesses work, is the assumption that this world is basically one large mining site, a mining platform, a production platform, a warehouse, a store. And so much of this world has been rendered into a commodity that can then be sold, purchased, appropriated. We know that we have an economy that operates according to the movement of extraction, and then also an ever-expanding market to distribute the things that have been exploited. Now, this is a rather harsh way, but we've only got a few minutes, so I have to speak bluntly here. What if that's not the kind of world we live in? What if this is all turning out to be a colossal mistake when we think that a commodified approach to the way the world is in fact the true way to think about it? And this is, I think, where religious traditions, but also indigenous traditions, have so much to teach us, because according to their position, and there are variations, obviously, this world is not a place that is a warehouse of commodities. This place is a sacred gift, and that all the creatures that live on this earth are also sacred beings. This means that if we inhabit a sacred realm, the world is not to be commodified. Instead, the world is to be honored and respected, even to be cherished. Now, there are lots of ways that we can talk about what makes this world sacred, but one of the most basic notions that we find throughout many traditions is the idea that this world is a created world. It didn't have to exist. It's not simply a mechanical, valueless, dead realm. It is, in fact, the material expression of a divine intention that the world should exist and in its existing be good and beautiful. So what we have to think through then is, how do we learn to cherish the world? And I don't have a silver bullet answer here, but I have one major suggestion, which might not seem that important, but is in fact huge. And that is for all of us to begin speaking with all the people that we know and meet about what kind of a world do they believe themselves to inhabit. When you meet politicians, when you meet neighbors, when you meet church leaders, when you meet people in a store, ask them, what kind of a world are we in? Do we love the things that surround us? Do we view fellow creatures as beings imbued with sanctity, calling forth our respect? I think we need to get to the place where we can engage people around what they love and what they cherish, because we know that we've got some dark periods ahead, and it's going to be the love of the sanctity of this life that is going to carry us through, I think.
Thank you very much. That was an extraordinary overview of all the subjects that we're going to be looking at tonight. So we're going to talk about this from different realms, as I mentioned, from science, from ecology, from politics. And so we're going to start with David Heurtel, who is counsel at Fasken, a large Canadian law firm, and adjunct professor at Concordia University in Montreal. And he teaches in the Masters in Public Policy and Public Administration program. And he's also a policy analyst for CJAD 800 and CTV News in Montreal. In Quebec's Liberal government, he was Minister of Sustainable Development, Environment, and the Fight Against Climate Change from 2014 to 2017. David is chairman of the Ali et les Princesses de la Rue, a stay-at-home Montreal nonprofit, and is a board member of Justice Pro Bono and Écothèque Québec. He is also a member of the Expert Advisory Committee of the Association of Canadian Studies COVID-19 Social Impact Network. David, Canada signed Kyoto and then went on to have one of the worst records in the world for increases in climate in greenhouse gases. Mr. Chrétien's chief of staff said they had signed it to galvanize public opinion, but they never really had a plan, and it showed. Then we went on to become the first country in the world to withdraw from the Kyoto Protocol. We signed the Paris Accord in 2015, but then we've had the worst record of all the G7 countries, and we've had an increase in greenhouse gases every year since. So David, I'm going to ask you straight up. You've been a minister, you know the tools of public administration. From that perspective, what do we have to do differently to get the result we all want?
Well, Tom, thank you for that very easy question. As you know, this is not an easy subject to tackle, but a subject we need to tackle nonetheless. It's a great pleasure to be with you this evening. What we need to do, actually, and I love the theme, what can I do? It really starts, and we kind of forget this from a political angle, that it does start with the individual. It starts with each of us understanding that we have the power with our vote to make a change. I mean, sometimes we lose that conception. And the fact is that as Canadians, And you saw it yourself. You are a former politician yourself. You're a former environment minister yourself in Quebec. The fact is that we just had a federal campaign in Canada and climate change was barely mentioned during the campaign. Same thing in the most recent provincial election campaigns from the Maritimes all the way to British Columbia, and go back to 2018 in Quebec and Ontario, climate change was not an issue. And recent polling, while people say that climate change is an important issue to them, when it comes time to voting, climate change is not the driving issue that decides their vote. And especially coming out of a pandemic, and some people say we're still in a pandemic, and we actually are still in a pandemic, but hopefully we are coming out of it. There's going to be a lot of different focuses. There's going to be a focus on the economy. There's going to be focus on the healthcare systems across the country that are in dire need of help and support and just overhauling. But yet that slow moving crisis, which is climate change, is still with us. And so the idea here, politically speaking, while we, and what you've said in your introduction is all true, we have to find a way individually to come together and put the issue at the forefront to force political change. And while I was going to make, you know, other remarks, I couldn't have timed this better myself if I would have planned it. Just as we were waiting to come on, breaking news from the New York Times at 7:06 p.m., the heart of President Biden's climate agenda is said to likely be cut from the budget bill because Senator Joe Manchin opposes it. And that just says it right away. The politics right now are just not there. And I don't want to get into the whole situation in the United States, but it just gives you an example of how politics is so fundamental, because individually, everybody's going to say, we want to do something about climate change. And we all try to make an effort. And as Dr. Wirzba said, I mean, we have to, we're compelled to do this. Yet politically, the transition right now, and that's the key here, the transition from a fossil fuel-based economy to a clean tech economy is very difficult to do. And I remember in 2019, which seems like the prehistoric times, Tom, when Greta Thunberg came to Montreal, and there were 500,000 people in the streets of Montreal. Remember, Tom? There are 500,000 people. And these images went around the world. This was like a moment. And we all thought that, okay, finally, this is the tipping point, right? Well, as you said, it did not happen. And a few weeks later, interestingly enough, President Obama came to Montreal and was asked about Greta Thunberg and her visit and her message about climate change. And President Obama had an amazing answer to this, and I'll end on this. He said, yeah, Greta Thunberg has a great message, but as president, when I was president, I couldn't tell a guy who had a job in the oil and gas industry and who supported his family with that job that he had to stop. He had to leave that job. And just from one day to another, just had to stop. Just like he couldn't force another country like India or China, which are major polluters along with the United States, to just stop growing and stop developing their economies. So the transition right now we're in is very complex, very difficult, as we can see, with what President Biden has to do, even within his own party.
Very
so. And right now, Justin Trudeau, the prime minister, has that same challenge, because at the end of the day, Canada is still very much an oil and gas based economy. Yeah, and that transition is the key. And I'll stop there. Sorry about that.
Very well said. No, I mean, to prove your point, we learned last week that the United States will burn 23% more coal during Joe Biden's first year in office than it did during Donald Trump's last year in office. And that's because the economy is cranking up. They need more electricity and they're, as we come out of the pandemic. And you can be sure that the same pressure, because there's a lack of sources of energy, fossil fuels are going to be burned more and extracted more in Canada. And that really does make it more difficult. So let's change our perspective a little bit. Let's rotate towards Dr. Jessica Moerman. She's the Senior Director for Science and Policy at the Evangelical Environmental Network. Dr. Moerman received her PhD in Earth and Atmospheric Sciences from the Georgia Institute of Technology and has held senior research positions at Johns Hopkins University, University of Michigan, the Smithsonian, National Museum of Natural History, and researched how climate has changed throughout Earth's history. Dr. Moerman is passionate about leading church communities towards positive solutions to safeguard our cities, neighborhoods, and the next generation from the effects of a warming world. She volunteers at the church, which she and her husband co-founded in 2016 in the DuPont Circle neighborhood in Washington, D.C. Dr. Moerman, welcome. And I'm just going to ask you with a question to set this up. How does your faith intersect with your work as an environmental scientist?
Thanks, Tom. It's a real pleasure to be here. And my faith has been key to setting the trajectory for me becoming a climate scientist. I became a climate and environmental scientist because of my faith in Christ. As a young person looking to figure out, God, how can I serve you? And asking him this, and then being led through a series of events to hear him say, you can serve me and serve others by becoming a climate scientist. And I tell this story because I feel like it's important for us as Christians to keep in mind that we don't have to change our values or adopt new values to care for the environment. It's right there in our scriptures from the very beginning to the very end of the Bible that God is calling us as his children to be good stewards of his creation. And for me personally, the connection that really ties my identity as a follower of Christ with climate science is life. And we've already touched on that tonight of the importance of a healthy environment and a safe climate for everyone to thrive in. And then also of livelihoods of as we are looking to transition to a clean economy to make sure that that is done in a just way. And it's really thorny, just as we've just earlier discussed. And that's why I think it's really important that we as Christians and people of faith are as in that conversation, because we have a care of making sure that everyone has that life abundant that Jesus came to give. He says in John 10:10 that he came so that all people may have life and have it to the full. And so, yes, that does mean having that health and healthy environment and having that safe climate, but it also means being able to have a family sustaining job and to take care of your children. And so these are difficult things to hold in tension. And that's why I think it is so important that we as people of faith are in these conversations. And as you said, I am a climate scientist. Sometimes in our community, some folks may find science a bit of a contentious issue. For me, I see science as simply studying God's creation. And what creation is telling us is that we have a problem. We have a climate problem that is, again, threatening lives and as well as livelihoods too, with heat waves that we've seen, the floods, the droughts, but we also have a pollution problem. And this pollution problem is cutting lives short. And it's robbing our children of their God-given potential by having lifelong ailments like asthma, learning disabilities, birth defects. But the good news is that when we look to see what we can do about both the climate crisis and the pollution crisis, we find that the solutions are often one and the same. And I find this incredibly hopeful because it means that we can address both solutions with, or both problems with the same solution. And what's also really wonderful is that because we know that it is us, that is us causing climate change and not just part of a natural cycle, we know that we can do something about it. God, who is the ultimate innovator, he has given us that innovative spirit to come up with those solutions. We have the tools, the know-how to address both of these crises. And so what can we do? How do we go about doing that? We've talked about tonight already the individual and household actions, as well as those collective actions. And we need both. I find individual actions so powerful. I like to think of them as creation care tithes or climate tithes to the Lord. First, just as Christians, this is our way that we honor God by showing him that we are caring for the works of his hands and the things that he's entrusted us with. But they're also really powerful because they're an easy way to share with others why you care about climate change or environmental pollution, because sometimes it can be hard to get that conversation rolling, but being able to point to something that you are doing yourself and telling people why is a great way to maximize your own impact. And then I'll just say finally that, again, this is such a large problem. It's not something that one person can say, can address all on their own. And so we do have to work collectively. And so I just want to give this word of encouragement that especially us as Christians and people of faith, when we lift our voices together, people pay attention. And so my prayer for this conference is that folks come out of it just really, really inspired to lift your voices together, especially as elections are coming up, and let your leaders know that this is really important to you, because your voice, especially together as the body of Christ, has a lot of power in that.
That is in and of itself very powerful. And thank you for sharing, Jessica. I've taken good note, and I love the way you summarized it by saying it's a question of honoring God by caring for his creation. Very, very powerful indeed. Our next panelist is Dr. Carolyn Begg. She's a faculty lecturer in the Department of Plant Science at MacDonald College of McGill University. Dr. Begg has worked in the field of sustainable agriculture in Tanzania and the Philippines, with her main interest in ecological agriculture. She carries out research on food security on the island of Montreal and on ecological agricultural practices, focusing on soil and crop management. Dr. Begg also mentors the McDonald's student-run ecological garden. She's president of the Marché Sainte-Anne Farmers Market, vice president of École au Champ, an agricultural education organization, and she serves on the board of Corbeille de Pain, a food security organization in the West Island. Dr. Begg, Caroline, in what way does your work in resilient soils inform your view of the climate crisis?
Thank you very much, Thomas. And I want to say some of the things I might say are going to reflect on what everybody else has said. As well, what I'm going to say is much more, I'm going to say, at the grassroots level. I work with a lot, teach a lot of students who are going to be future farmers. All of my students are all future and right away, right now, consumers. And all of the students that I'm working with and all the farmers I've worked with in the past, they all know that they're stewards of the land and the animals, and they also understand how everything is connected and how their decisions on the farm will impact themselves and into the future and the environment. And as has been said, we're kind of living the effects of climate change right now. We've got the droughts, we've got the floods, the extreme temperatures. And the problem is that this creates huge risks for farmers. These are risks that they have to take into account. And unfortunately, one of the things that I think we have a real problem with, and this is also climate change, it's also how things are working together, is the food system. The consumers, the food system, I know some of the people that I go and see, they overproduce on their farm because the grocery stores want to have readily available product, and then some of that food goes to waste, and then the farmers get criticized for producing too much food, but then prices are going up, and it's just a very complicated system. But the thing is, I want to say that as Jessica said, we're all in this together. We're not, this is also the consumers, this is the farmers, this is everybody. where we can't have silos anymore. We can't just individually try and do things, that we're all into this together. But the main thing is that we can have small changes either on the farm or our own lifestyle can really have huge, all together have large impacts and can mitigate some of these changes. As I said, you know, my passion is the soil. I'm all for soil. I'm all for regenerative agriculture. For those of you who are here, I don't know how many of you are in farming. There's a lot of different groups out there now that are actually very inspiring to go and listen to these different groups, how they're changing their system bit by bit on the farm, and they're seeing positive results. They have soils that are healthier, more biologically diverse. They're more resilient. And in these this day, we need to have this, but they're also storing carbon. They're also, there's less erosion, so there's less nutrient runoff, and they're, it's better food for the animals and for ourselves as well. The other thing is that trying to reduce our food waste, and this is both on the consumer side and on the producer side, loss in the field sometimes is unavoidable, but unfortunately the media is very focused on what goes on, you know, in the field, things that are being lost, but less focused on how much we're throwing out from our fridges. And we can help to reduce this. This might be a way of reducing foods, the issues of food security. But one of the things is that it just makes you feel better when you don't waste things. And I go back to my when I was on my grandmother's farm, and this is a long time ago, nothing was ever wasted. We didn't throw away anything, and it was always reused. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Carolyn. That's so important. And I also understand, as I was listening to you, that that's probably one of the areas where people can act the most on their own, because it's easy to reduce the amount of food that you waste. And, you know, the production of methane that accompanies large animal production and the consumption of meat. I have to share an anecdote. At the beginning of this term, I was noticing more and more that the students were not consuming meat, and it was partly ethical, but it was also having to do with climate change. So I have a graduate class of 77 students, and I just said, show of hands, how many of you don't eat meat? And it was about 80%. And nobody pushes that on them. It's just something that they realize is part of the changing the type of world that we're in. And given tonight's topic, what can I do? I guess that can also be on the list. And changing agricultural practices, moving away from the types of things that we've done in the past to a more ecological perspective that you've been working on so incredibly. Oops, there we go. That you've been working on so incredibly. That's something that we can all be very proud of. I think that now's the time for us to move towards the next section, which is going to be the open discussion amongst the panelists. And what I would propose to do then is to just throw out a question to some of you to all of you, and ask for your view on the following. Back in the 1960s, John F. Kennedy was informed that strontium 90 was making its way around the world after various nuclear tests. Now, the problem there, of course, was that there was nothing stopping those nuclear tests, and they were able to find out that strontium 90 was making its way into the pulp of the baby teeth of children around the world. We were actually being encouraged at the time to send in our tooth, get a little badge that you could put on that said, I gave my tooth to science. Kennedy took note of that, and there was an emotional connection. He had young children when he was in the White House. He and Khrushchev, despite the fact that it was the top of the Cold War, got together and came up with a test ban treaty to get rid of atmospheric testing. Some countries took a little bit longer to get it right, but that was the basic idea. Brian Mulroney and George H.W. Bush got together and did something about acid rain. They came up with the first cap and trade system to reduce, you put a ceiling and you reduced regularly for the SO2, that was mixing with the water and producing acid rain, especially in the northeast of the United States and in eastern Canada. It worked. So you can act on these big environmental crises, but I wonder if you don't have to make some sort of emotional connection, some sort of ethical connection. You know, you're thinking about children's teeth. You're thinking about something that for you is very important, like a maple stand that's dying from acid rain. Ronald Reagan was anything but a scientist, but when NASA came to him and told him that there was a big hole opening up in the ozone layer and that it could have a devastating effect on life on Earth, he put the best scientific minds together. They came to Montreal, and the United Nations signed the Montreal Protocol to get rid of CFCs, chlorofluorocarbons, and it worked. So there have been solutions in the past. And when there is a real crisis and emergency, we saw that around COVID-19, the world could come together rapidly. The best scientific minds could come up with vaccines. We could act on it. And everybody got behind that, except for a very small tranche of people who denied the science. But overall, the planet came together and acted on that. So I'm just going to throw this out. Does it require an emotional connection? How do we get? We all seem to agree that it starts with the individual pushing perhaps the politicians, perhaps doing things on their own, like consuming less meat, that will have an effect. But how do we get people moving? 500,000 people in the street, referenced by David Heurtel back in September of 2019. But how do we translate that into a result? Any thoughts, Norman?
Yeah, this is it's a really important question, Tom. And I wonder how the circumstances have changed since the 60s, 70s, 80s, and so forth. Because when David just announced about the New York Times breaking news story, it was utterly devastating to me, because it's just one more indication about the grip of money. We don't need more scientific data. It is plain as day what is coming our way. And you'd have to stick your head in the sand not to realize this is what's coming. But the power of money to convince people to do what they know is not good for their grandchildren. It's beyond sad for me to have heard that story breaking tonight. And I don't know what the best way to go. And I'm not so convinced that when we talk about what I should do, that the focus should always be on individual action. I think it's very important, but I think climate change is not an issue of personal virtue or vice. I think climate change is an issue of systems, and they are economic systems that are powerful. They're extremely well funded and entrenched, and we need to lay bare the strategies by which these entrenched, highly financed interests are having the access to power, so that a single individual can derail a country's progress on what is undeniably the most important issue facing our young people. I talk to young people all the time, and they tell me they're trying to decide whether or not they can have children, because the world that they would bring them into is doomed. And if that's not enough to convince a politician to do something about this, I don't know what it will be. So I really think we need to start talking about systems and the financing of these systems. And we need to do that as faith communities as well.
Jessica?
Yeah, I agree that with making an emotional connection is so key, and to make the problem local and personal. One thing that we do at the Evangelical Environmental Network is we really focus on children's health. And just as Dr. Wirzba was saying, of thinking about the next generation. And one thing that we often do of when we're, because a lot of us, I know for myself, we get it immediately. We know that we need to care for God's creation. We are moved by the arguments of climate change, but then we have segments in our communities, folks in our communities, of where that message just isn't reaching them. And that's where we really use and where we focus on that connection, where climate solutions are pollution solutions, and focus on the pollution angle of how air pollution is really harming the health of our children. Asking a community, how many of your children have asthma, and seeing half of the congregation, their hands going up, and pointing out that clean cars, switching from diesel buses to electric school buses, using clean power to source our electricity from, those are going to be solutions to that air pollution from the soot that is linked to asthma, that's linked to birth defects in our children. And so we really focus on really driving home that personal connection and that emotional connection, because to get more people to act, they've got to see how our system of using fossil fuel powered vehicles and power stations really impacts them personally. Because sometimes it can feel really distant, but once they make that personal connection, then they're ready to move and act.
Carolyn, in the Paris Accord, every signatory is obliged to file at the United Nations annually a list that includes their best evaluation of greenhouse gases emitted by land use changes, agriculture, and forest fires. Everybody's always concentrating on the industrial side, but some of these numbers are absolutely out of control in Canada, especially the forest fires, and in Australia. From your experience, is that side of things, agriculture, going to be a major topic when the world comes together in 2 weeks in Glasgow, Scotland, to have this big United Nations conference on climate change? Is that going to be a chance for a breakthrough on the issues that you've worked hard on for so many years?
Probably not. Food inflation right now is very high. So any sort of sense of restricting food is a bit of a problem. Also, there's been a huge increase in the food insecure worldwide. I think it's over 350 million. There's 50 countries that are food insecure. There has been a huge increase, and that is quite a serious thing. So the other thing is that it's more complicated than just trying to reduce, I absolutely agree with reducing animal meat consumption. I absolutely agree with this. However, I also see my students who are very good stewards of the land and have regenerative systems. That if you look at, one of the things is if you look at when the bison were here, there were millions of bison, ruminants, methane, etc. It's a complicated system. It's not that simple as saying get rid of the beef or get rid of this. And it's also for those countries emerging from food insecure or getting a little bit more wealthy, meat is a status. It's also high protein. There's all kinds of things. But so for me, it's changing the things on the ground that we can do here. We can reduce nitrous oxide emissions. We can reduce carbon loss from the fields. And there is movement in that area. And I don't, with my students, they're young and I try not to be negative because it can be so demoralizing. It can be incredibly demoralizing for them because they're trying to move into to produce food for all of us. And if I'm sitting there saying, oh, you're really bad, this is not how I talk about things to them.
I couldn't agree with you more. And I think that we're sometimes almost blamed for saying that we can remain optimistic. But when I go through that list of successes, the test ban treaty, because we tested and we knew that the strontium was making it into kids' bodies. When you go through the Montreal protocol to get rid of CFCs, the hope is there because the examples are there where we've gotten it done in the past. But I think it goes back to Norman's point with regard to our economic system that makes it very hard to produce the type of serious change that would be required. Just yesterday, the International Energy Agency, for the first time, changed its way of stating things because they've always in the past sort of said, well, this is going to happen because this is what's going to happen and we're heading to that. But now they're saying, well, if we actually are serious about 1.5 degrees change in this century, then we've got to basically stop any increase whatsoever in the use of fossil fuels. So that's the first time that somewhat bureaucratic agency has almost taken a stand, and it's quite a sea change. David, what's your take on that?
Well, I look at it obviously through the lens of politics and finance, and the idea here is, interestingly enough, to Caroline's point, when I was environment minister, we actually put money in technology that reduces methane emission in cows by just changing their diet. And so there are ways to control that. But at the end of the day, if we're really serious about this, and you know this, Tom, we're trying to put, for example, a price on carbon. There's a carbon tax in Canada that should go to $50 a ton in the next few years. But every credible scientific source says that if we were serious about putting a real price on carbon, we would be talking between $100 and $200 a ton.
US.
And same thing for gas, for gasoline. We pay, everybody's going crazy here in Montreal because gas is now $1.50 a liter. Well, if we were in Europe, that would be a steal, $1.50 a liter. I mean, we in Europe, they're paying more than twice that. And if we have to look at this from the point of view that when we do, what can I do? Yes, we have to change our behaviors, how we consume, all that is all very good, and we have to do that. But also we have to understand that there's going to have at some point a sacrifice in terms of how we view our economic situations. And the fact is that if we don't start making those sacrifices right now, we're going to pay a much larger price later. And that's a fact. And so the idea here is that I think we really need to look at this from realistic point of view. We have a federal government, as you know, we've talked about this at length in the media, you and I, Tom. But the fact is we have a government that has a platform that is supposedly pro fighting climate change, yet this government is buying pipelines and subsidizing the oil and gas industry. And so how do we work on that transition? How do we, because all the scientific advice that we know says that what? It's 70 or 80% of the oil and gas reserves that are known in the world has to stay in the ground if we're going to achieve 1.5% reduction by 2050. And so that means a massive seismic shift, economically speaking, for Canada. And even here in Quebec, you know, in Quebec, we talk about Hydro-Quebec and everything. Oh, we have clean energy. Well, it's only 50% of our total energy consumption that is clean. The other 50 is still oil and gas. So we really need to shift this in a big way. So politically and financially, there's going to have to be big moves. And it goes back to the individual forcing those changes.
Gonna have to be. Norman wanted to get in here.
Yeah. I want to follow up because this is fascinating and very important, I think, about policy. I want to bring it back to agriculture because I study agriculture. So I'm really glad that you're with us, Caroline, to talk about this because, you know, I have to speak more from the American context, which I know, but we have a farm bill right now that is going to guarantee that we're not going to treat our land properly. And it's a farm bill that is so much driven by big commodity production interests, right? Corn, soybean. And we know that regenerative agriculture does tremendous things in terms of cleaning water, increasing soil fertility, reducing farmer indebtedness, if we get the policies that give these farmers a chance. Because right now, so many of the subsidies go to commodities growers, and they don't go to farmers who are growing real food. So this is a part about educating food consumers so they understand how the food choices they make are supporting a system that not only harms the land, harms farmers, but harms their own diet. So education is going to play a very, very important role because we know what we need to do in agriculture to reduce carbon emissions. We know what we need to do to increase fertility, clean our waters. We know how to do that. But right now, farmers who want to do it can't because the policies are in place to make sure that that work is going to be impossible. I talk to lots of young farmers. They can't do what they want to do because the economics are impossible.
Caroline, Tom, I suspect you want to add a little something to that.
I do agree with you, but I think the changes are happening at very low grassroots levels that maybe we're just not completely aware of, because I have been part of a number of different forums where people are talking about the things that they're doing and they're changing and everything. I do agree that it is commodity based, but when I'm teaching, when the first thing I do this, I always say, you know, to me, the greatest problem that we have is cheap food. But I mean, I also, on the other hand, I also say I'm wealthy enough that I don't have a problem buying food, but I, you know, but the problem is cheap food, and that cascades down through the system. And then everybody, whether it's policy, whether it's everything else, but that's the problem. We have cheap food, so we can buy an iPhone, you know, and then, you know, you're the person you go to in the store says, oh, your phone is old. You know, it's only 5 years, it's still functioning, but it's too old. You must get a new one. So all of that, you know, goes to waste. It's a very, to me, you know, I keep telling, you know, the food system is very complex. It does start a little bit though with our own change in our own behavior. That is part of it, but cheap food is kind of forcing all these systems. But I understand there's a huge amount of poverty. So I don't want to, yeah, there is that.
And farm poverty too.
You know? Yes, yeah.
Well, if you go to the grocery store, for example, okay, I give that example actually in my classes. So I go to the grocery store and just buying garlic. Just take garlic, which is a very simple example. Garlic from China is 99 cents. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Garlic from Quebec is $1.49. Mm-hmm. Now, are we going to make that choice? Not everybody can make that choice ethically. Yeah. And it's the same thing with the, and I won't name a store chain or whatever, but the cheaper product brands, I mean, they're making billions of dollars because they have the cheaper products, and the cheaper products come from where? They don't come from local sources. And so when I talk about sacrifices economically, that's also the same thing. So how does government intervene? How does private corporations intervene? How do people like, I suspect, most of us here tonight who are more fortunate make that ethical choice to maybe spend more to actually help people that do not have that capacity to pay more for the ethical, the climate conscious choice, because that's the key here, because a lot of people can't make that choice.
I completely agree.
Jessica, I'd like to get you to speak to us a little bit about your point of view on a sea change that occurred with the report that was brought forward by the United Nations on our common future. Gro Harlem Brundtland, former Prime Minister of Norway, commissioned that report and invited us to do something that we hadn't been doing spontaneously, which is to think about the effect on future generations of every decision that we took in government, for example. That almost becomes an ethical precept. In his remarks, Norman talked to us about Indigenous traditions of viewing creation as a sacred gift, but we know that there are a lot of Indigenous communities across North America that for millennia had always said that you had to look at the effect of a decision over seven generations. That was something that was thought in place long before the United Nations asked Gro Harlem Brundtland for her landmark report. That goes to our other conversation that we were having at the beginning about how you get people to make an emotional connection, and it is ethical. Do you find that that type of message about our obligation to future generations is one that can be easily communicated?
I think it really is something that we can easily communicate. And even within our Christian community of looking to the Proverbs of where it says that we pass on to a good grandmother passes on an inheritance to their grandchildren. And so that same idea is in our scriptures. And so we can point to that also. And I think what is really important is that to make that case for our community for the next generation, I think is a really easy one. Right now, I just had my second son, and he is going to see, I hope, the 2100 world. That was really mind-blowing to me that as we're talking about these really far out years, dates, children alive today are going to see that world. And so when we're talking 2050, when we're talking 2100, it's not abstract anymore. And so really helping people make that connection that your grandchildren, your children are, this is the world that they are inheriting. And especially the decisions that we make in the next 10 years have the most impact moving forward. I think that is really inspiring to and communicates the urgency of what we need to do. But again, it's a thorny issue. There's a lot of balance across making sure that choices are equitable, that that the choices that we make, the policies we put in place are just, that the that there aren't harmful unintended consequences. And so again, that's why it's, I'll just say that I'm really heartened to see all of these different climate discussions and seeing the folks in the Congress in the US as well as the Parliament in Canada really, really working to hammer out different policies and looking at it from different angles instead of just ignoring it. Norman, you mentioned the farm bill, and it was great that at least in the last iteration, the reauthorization of that, that there was a climate title in it. So that's a start. I'm looking forward to the next reauthorization of that farm bill to put even more climate provisions into that. And so as we keep on lifting our voice as the body of Christ, that's going to keep that conversation going.
Norman?
Yeah, no, I think it's absolutely important. I've been to DC to lobby with different faith groups and Humane Society to try to get our senators and congressional leaders to take seriously the question of values. And this is a really, I think, hopeful sign, at least in this country, where politicians are sometimes very leery of speaking to people if you get into data. But if you get to the question about your faith commitments, right, that's often a level that you can speak to our elected officials with. I don't know how that plays in other parts of the world. I know I spoke once to the environment minister in Sweden, and he said, you can't bring up religion here. That's a non-starter for us. So you have to have different strategies. And I think part of what being a good citizen requires of us is that we become mobilized and knowledgeable about tactics. This is not a let's play nice kind of game where we can just say, if we say the right things, people will do the right things. We have to be savvy about what's going on in our world and know where the levers of power are, the levers that are going to be the system changing levers. And we need to put our energy in the right places, which is why I made the point earlier, let's not just keep the conversation on the level of personal vice and virtue. Let's make sure that we're constantly thinking about how, as communities, we can mobilize our people to first educate them, but then also get them to elected offices, but not just to politicians' offices. We need to also start going to businesses, because we know that the power of business is driving often what goes on in our political offices.
Well said. Well, let's go with that a little bit, and then we'll start winding down and get to the part where we're going to do our Q&A with the people who have joined us this evening. But Norman and David, I'm thinking mostly of some of your interventions. If you go through it, if you go, for example, to the Porter hypothesis, that actually putting in place, you know, restrictions and requirements and norms and results that are imposed on businesses, it actually creates more savings because they have to be more efficient. It brings about more innovation. It's been proven time and again. Nordhaus and Rahmer, two Americans who won the Nobel Prize in Economics back in 2018, all of their work goes in the same direction of that. So Nicholas Stern's report, which showed us years ago that if we don't deal with climate change now, it will cost us a lot to deal with it now, but it's going to cost infinitely more if we don't deal with it. How do we make the leap into the real world? I mean, this is rock solid academic analysis and economic analysis, but how do we make the leap to talk to people in Jessica's congregation and say, no, it's not just an idea that we have to think of future generations, because if we don't, they won't have the same standard of living and they won't have any the things that we take for granted, because we'll have taken up too much and we won't have been good stewards. How do we make that leap? How do we convince people that that's the case?
David? Can I just briefly mention, sure, and then go ahead, Carol, to David and Norman. The thing is, a lot of the big food companies have already moved in that direction. McDonald's is committed to 50 million acres of sustainably produced beef by 2022 or 2023. Unilever, the same way. They want to have fair wages for most of their products. They're, a lot of the big companies, and this includes A&W, all the big food chains, they're all moving in this direction. It's under the government policy. The problem is this, it's not associated with the government. But whatever these big food chains dictate is what the farmers have to follow. And so it's an interesting thing what's out there. You see this with a lot, if you go onto their websites, they all have commitments to climate change, to sustainability in agriculture, all of this. But it's being impacted by the consumers, not by the governments. So just to mention, it's out there in business.
So there are outside forces as well, not just the next government policy or the next conference.
Oh, I don't even think they're concerned about the next government policy. All they're concerned about is their consumer walking in. Remember with McDonald's when they had the styrofoam and then everybody protested and now we don't have styrofoam. So it's shifting and it's the consumers are doing it.
Right. And that can help produce a result as well. That's a really great point, Carolyn. Thank you. And I think that we can see that those outside influences are going to continue to play. It wasn't Congress that got the big tobacco companies to change their practices of trying to hook kids young. It was hundreds of billions of dollars of lawsuits that they had to pay out in damages. Right now, the big oil companies are being sued by the city of New York and the state of California to the tune of hundreds of billions of dollars because they knew about climate change's dangers the same way big tobacco knew about the dangers of tobacco. Yet the tobacco companies for years would sue doctors who said that tobacco was causing cancer because they had the ability to do that. Sometimes it's these outside forces that also have to combine and come together at just the right time to help force that result. And indeed, to hear you, you're telling, Carolyn, it's, the government itself is sometimes the laggard here and not the leader.
I'll jump in
and just note that even though there was definite disappointment and dismay not to see things during the Obama administration, like the Waxman-Markey bill with cap and trade, not seeing the Clean Power Plan move forward at the EPA, the business community, the marketplace, they took notice and started to shift knowing that this is down the track. We've got to prepare ourselves for that future. And so we are seeing that market-driven change to where it will, in the sense that if you look at the Lazard analysis of the cost of different energy sources, you see that whenever you take subsidies off the table, put it on a level playing field, that utility scale wind and solar power are cheaper to build than new fossil fuels generating stations. And so we're beginning to see the markets really respond to where they anticipate that policy is going to be headed, and they don't want to be left behind. Again, that's not enough. We need to have policy at the federal level also moving us at the pace that we need to see carbon reductions happen. But it is really heartening to see the trend begin to move in the right direction.
Very, very well stated. In fact, when you look, when you pull back a little bit and you realize that market forces, again, big investment firms like BlackRock or Berkshire Hathaway. Berkshire was supposed to be a major partner in a big natural gas move towards the Saguenay region of Quebec and a big installation there. They pulled out of it. BlackRock has said they will no longer invest in fossil fuels. So the market is starting to play, but it's not just a question of making sure that they get profits for their investors. They're worried long-term about their liability. And they're looking over the horizon. So all of these forces have to come together in the right movement. And I'll just end by referencing Eleanor Ostrom, a wonderful thinker who looks at these big issues around the world. And she says, when enough people start to move, and I come back to David's image of the 500,000 people in the street in Montreal. I was covering that for one of the news outlets that I work for now. And it was, I was moved to tears. Simply by that presence of 500,000 people acting in unison with a common goal. So I think around the world, we've got many, many times that of people with the same type of concern that we have to make things better and to be responsible to our children and grandchildren. Meg, if this is all right with you, I think this would be a perfect time to start handing it over to you so that you can invite the delegates to indicate if they have a question or a reaction and perhaps who will be headed to. We're going to make sure that we wind down by the prescribed time of 9 p.m. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Tom. And thank you to all of our panelists who have been sharing. It's been fascinating to hear your interactions and to hear the conversation that's been happening so far. I am going to invite anyone at this point who has a question, use your reactions and you can raise your hand and then I will call on you in order. You can direct your question at a specific panelist if you'd like or a general question and I'll let our panelists answer it as they feel called. Hopefully there won't be too much of a brawl over who gets to answer first. So I'll ask James can ask the first question.
Thank you. It's been a very interesting and fascinating conversation, and there are many things that we need to think about. I want to pick up on one, and that is one of the issues is to ground action on climate change within economic reality. What I mean by that is that any action that we take has an associated cost involved. And the pushback in the public sphere has largely been it's too costly to make the changes. And the current hoopla over the cost of gasoline and oil and natural gas is a typical concern. That catches people's notice. Several of you have commented on the fact that those who don't have flexibility in their disposable income will choose the cheapest product because it's the only one they can afford. Now, the question I have is much broader than simply that, and it's this. In order to make the kind of changes that are required, there will be the need for financial sacrifice and financial investment. The difficulty from the politician's viewpoint and the government viewpoint, in my estimation, is credibility. Because we have at the present time, and it's been greatly exacerbated by the pandemic, a culture that expects the government to provide, and we don't concern ourselves with balancing, paying our way. And one of the things that people of faith who are good stewards need to be able to model and encourage and help facilitate in our conversation is that at the end of the day, we don't think there's a free lunch. We have our hands open to receive and recognize that everything is a gift from providence, from God. But we have a responsibility not to saddle children and grandchildren with the excesses of our living. And yet that's what we're doing. And there is no question, there's no comment, there's no discussion about a balanced budget, never mind paying off the debts we've already incurred. And so my question is, how do we responsibly address the issues financial that require structural change and sacrifice from a holistic viewpoint that addresses the real need to live in balance within our means?
Well, great question, James. It was specifically addressed to one of the members of the panel?
No, to all of you.
Okay. I'll let the panel members decide.
I'll just throw out a couple of brief things. One thing we need to do when we're talking about finances is have something like full cost accounting, which we just do not have right now. So much is off the books and is externalized and expected to be paid down the road. That's one thing. And the second thing I would say is, if we want to talk about balance, let's address the fact that 2% of the world's population has, what, 50% of the wealth? That is not balance. And we need to start talking about that gross, gross injustice.
And I would perhaps add that one of the best climate plans, and it was the essence of what Biden had been announcing, but he hasn't been able to get it off the ground, was something put together by actually two fairly conservative American politicians, one who just passed away. George Shultz just passed away at the venerable age of 102. He was still alive. And so James D. Baker III, they put together a proposal to have a very, very high carbon price, carbon offsets at the border to avoid free riders, to make sure that countries that weren't respecting the rules of the Paris Accord would be obliged to do so. Janet Yellen was very much a big fan of that prior to becoming Treasury Secretary. So I think that the thought is there. And then a key component of it was you would give a check back to families to compensate for the increased costs, but it would definitely have produced results. So it's not that we don't know the different tools of public administration that could be used. I think that very often we're just lacking the political courage to do it. And maybe that political courage will come when there are 500,000 people in the street in every major city around the world. Thank you for that, James. I'll let Meg call in the next question.
I'll invite Janet to ask her question.
Hi, Janet.
Hi. So my question starts with one word, justice. Climate justice. And I wanted to bring this into the conversation because justice, you know, with our church, we have justice ministries and climate justice is, my question is, where does justice, social justice play in the options being considered as solutions for climate? And the as I say this question, the example I wish to give is electric vehicles. So electric vehicles, the hype, the marketing hype, is that it will reduce greenhouse gas emissions. At whose cost? And so part of the, and this is the dilemma that I see, and I wanted to share it to see if there is another way of looking at this. Because a lot of people are being mobilized about around buying an electric vehicle at the rate of replacement of your old vehicle. So we have the same level of consumerism. But where do electric vehicles come from and how clean is the energy that is included in them? So justice is our choices in the North with our, you know, with people in the South. And is our choices being made in the North to the exclusion of the, you know, an appropriate lifestyle that we take for granted here, but to the exclusion of an appropriate lifestyle in the South? We all know that batteries, they are made from resources that are limited. And there is environmental degradation happening in Chile and in South Africa, and there are all kinds of working conditions associated with those places. So justice with climate, how does that work? And what do you see that we have to start looking at in order to really decide that yes, something like an electric vehicle is an appropriate choice if we in fact are stewards of the earth? And we're putting those appropriate choices on the table as a choice for us.
Well, that's a great set of observations, Janet. And I'm just going to throw it open to the panel, thinking that perhaps Carolyn might be able to help us because she's had the opportunity to work around the world. Her thoughts on the difference that Janet was pointing out in terms of justice for the global South.
Yeah, I completely understand. I mean, the electric vehicles, I mean, I guess my simple answer to that, simple, maybe not simple, but probably electric buses where you can use them for more people rather than the electric vehicles. And I think the electric vehicles are now being sold to the rich who want to feel better about what they're driving and et cetera. So I think that that, again, that's a marketing issue, which, you know, we have to get away from being seduced by marketing. I mean, you know, they employ companies to do the marketing, and it's very good. But one of the issues that we have in agriculture, I mean, when you talk about social justice, and this is what I bring up with my students all the time, because it's very concerning, is the reliance of, and I'm going to talk specifically with Canadian agriculture, is our reliance on migrant labor, on offshore labor. And the social justice associated with that is huge. I mean, there's ethical concerns. There's the fact that we have to rely on other people from other countries to come and harvest our food. And that's a great concern for me. And I don't have an easy solution. There are some, but I'll leave it at that. But social justice is part of food justice. That's all to me one and the same. It's linked.
Great. Thank you very, very much. Very helpful, Carolyn. Meg,
Tom, add a few comments to that, I'd love to. I think it's just a really wonderful question. And I think justice has to be kept front and center of all of our new policy formulations. And when it comes to electric vehicles, I just have three kind of points I want to address. First, to your question about the full life cycle emissions that come from electric vehicles. I think it's a study by the National Renewable Energy Laboratory here in the US that's looked at that and has seen, found that electric vehicles, their full life cycle carbon emissions is lower even when powered by fossil fueled electricity, is lower than other than gas powered vehicles. So that's good news. But you raise those two other issues of accessibility to for low income and low wealth and environmental justice communities to electric vehicles. And I think that's where really smart policy has to come in place, where incentives and the ability to afford an electric vehicle, there needs to be targeted programs that are means tested to allow for low-income communities to get access to those electric vehicles. And there's some local policies at different municipalities that have done that, and it's been very successful. But then to your other point of the sourcing of especially different elements, cobalt, that goes into electric vehicle batteries, and the ethical concerns with forced labor that's being used to mine that. That has to be addressed. We can't repeat the mistakes we've made in the past with taking advantage of people's health and taking advantage of people's freedom to resource whether that's coal or whatever resources is being mined. We can't repeat that mistake. I will say that one thing that does give me encouragement is that we are seeing, at least here in the U.S., the Department of Commerce and several senators really bring attention and a spotlight to the development of solar panels and polysilicon in China with the Uyghur community. And so I'm heartened to see that those ethical concerns are being addressed in that case. And I think it's really important that when it comes to cobalt as well, that we have keep that at the forefront of our policy decisions too.
Thank you very much. That was super helpful to remind us about the need on a technical level to look at the full life cycle analysis, but at the same time to remember that sustainable development is more, it's not only about the environment or the economic, it's also about the social and the impact that the extractive industries are having in many of those countries in the global south. Very, very good point. Very helpful. Meg, I'm going to suggest, because we have about a half an hour left, that you take maybe three questions in a row, and then perhaps various members of the panel can try to take parts of them and get some answers. That way, perhaps a larger number of participants will be able to get their questions in, if that's all right with you.
Sure, that sounds great. So Guy, if you'd like to share your question, let's start with you.
Thank you, panelists, for your very inspiring contributions and very thought-provoking. And I'm thinking about the recent federal election that we had, and it's true that we didn't hear much about the climate emergency. And I think we know that the issues we're tackling require very difficult decisions that are politically challenging and can turn people off if they will be affected negatively economically and so on. So we also see, and we have a couple of formerly elected officials here with us. So our electoral system is designed to create a toxic environment where people are undermining one another, and it's not easy to come to a consensus to face those very big challenges together. Now, I know that some have suggested that electoral reform could lead to some form of proportional representation systems that may lead to more collaborative decision-making when it comes to the common good, such as the climate emergency that we're facing. So I'd like to hear your thoughts on the suggestion of a citizens' assembly to assess, study our electoral system and to see if something better could be proposed, and therefore the political cost to any individual party right now would be minimized if there was an agreement to move in a direction that all would be willing to follow.
All right, thank you, Guy. And just before we get responses from panelists, I'll also get Carolyn's question, and maybe we'll work with two and see how that goes and go from there.
Perfect.
Okay, mine are three policy questions, and one of them Carolyn might be able to answer, is ask about the reduction of herbicides, which is a health and environmental one, and changing the policy on labeling from best before to use by, which would reduce wastage of food, and imposing, I don't know if we can impose a carbon tax on imports of the products that we produce at the same time, you know, like when we've got a bounty of vegetables or things, can we impose a carbon tax on imports of the same foods so that the prices will be equal and therefore purchasers will choose the local ones above the imported ones?
All right, so we have a question about proportional representation as it might affect the ability to move forward with policy, and questions around food policies.
I'll take a crack at the electoral reform one. Thanks, Guy, for reminding us that there's one subject that we seem to have even more trouble dealing with in Canada than climate change, and it's electoral reform. Because as you know, it was a hard and fast promise that 2015, Mr. Trudeau said it was going to be the last election with the unfair first past the post system. Committees got together, they had ideas, and Mr. Trudeau essentially said, look, I'm not going to change the system that's allowed us to share power with the Conservatives for the past 150 years at the time, a little bit more than that now. And here in Quebec, there was a solemn promise to go towards a more proportional representation. And of course, Mr. Legault, for the exact same reason, has just recently announced that he won't be doing it either. So I think that you're right, that a better system, a better democratic system would certainly allow us to have that voice that is being expressed sometimes in the streets, sometimes in churches, sometimes in community and environmental groups, have it heard and acted upon more than it has been. I think it's an interesting point how all these big issues are connected. I'm going to let Carolyn take Carolyn's question on herbicides and on a carbon tax on imported goods as well, if she's comfortable with that.
Yeah, no, there's a couple of points. In Quebec, they are looking, or the island of Montreal is looking to ban herbicides. I just want to say it's kind of a complicated situation because it goes back to the increase in prices that we may see in food. Since I'm supportive of ecological agriculture or biologique or organic, I am opposed to herbicides, but I understand that it's in part of the system right now. So it's a more complex thing to think about how you would change this. But there are farmers out there that are seriously looking at reducing. So this is what I'm very, you know, encouraged about. Going to the best before date, yes, that's a random number that the companies choose and they put on the products just so that they think it's better before this, but is it bad for you after? No, it's a matter of education. It's a matter of just knowing that you, again, for me, as long as It's all edible for me. You know, I don't like to throw things away. It's I was brought up, never throw things away. But again, that's just, there is no real science behind that. The food though is about a lot more complicated. A lot of the grocery stores, when they buy food, like even though in summertime we have lots of, let's say, squash right now, and you see some squash imported, some of these grocery stores have obligations with other areas where they, if they want to buy this, then they have to buy that. And it becomes difficult. And also it's distribution chains, there's all kinds of things. But again, the best thing you can do is walk into the store and say, I want to have local produced product. And they're responsive to that. They really are responsive to that.
Perfect.
Yeah, can I just follow up on that? Here in North Carolina, we have a large agriculture sector, and it was just wonderful to see how they some organizations here started an NC Choice campaign, which was encouraging North Carolina residents to buy groceries from farmers from North Carolina. And consumers were quite happy to do it. They didn't know that so much of the food was not from North Carolina. And it did a tremendously good job bolstering good farming in North Carolina.
Great. That's an excellent positive example. Thank you very much for sharing that, Norman. So I'll let you take the next couple, Meg. That worked out well. We were moving along.
So I'll invite Colleen to ask her question and then Ghassan after.
Now I'm unmuted. I'd like to hear some of the panelists talk about energy ratios. If I don't really know a lot about it, I just kind of heard someone talking about it on a DVD. But like, you know, the fossil fuel, it was a game changer, because pre-industrial, you know, you had certain amount of energy put in input and productivity output, you know, ratios were like 1 in 5, 1 in 1, 1 in 2, whatever. And but then with the fossil fuels, it became 1 in 15. And so all of a sudden, there was this whole new level of wealth that was created. And I mean, and that's what has fueled our modern world. And so when we move away from that, are we moving away from those kinds of ratios? And inevitably, that will mean a much lower standard of living, a much more subsistence level of living. I know lots of people still subsist, but, you know, Canada, we're nowhere near that. We don't subsist here. And there's no way we're going to go back to subsisting. You know, my father was a child in the Depression. I spoken to all sorts of elders who grew up in that era. They don't want to go back. So what are we really talking about?
Thanks, Colleen.
I'll just leave it at that.
All right, and Ghassan?
Yes, I know it's a short time, but I have two small questions, really. One to Mr. Mulcair. I wanted to ask him from his background, political background, is there any future generation representative or consideration when the politicals make decision on futuristic policies? And the second is for Dr. Jessica. Since consumers have a large impact on corporate, like Dr. Caroline told us, McDonald and the styrofoam issue, can Christian add to the fight to avoid global warming by revisiting, let's say, the service structure, introduce creation and creation stewardship in all our prayers, educate faithful on to become good stewards, churches to use solar systems, stop use of plastic, youth to go work with A Russia and Green Church, etc. I mean, out of 2.2 billion registered Christian, if a third of that are practicing their religion, maybe that will have a big impact on the avoiding the global warming.
Well, those are, again, a couple of really great questions. David, I'm going to call upon you. to try to take on Colleen's question about the energy mix, but about the effect on our standard of living if we were to move in that direction. We've talked about the Nicholas Stern's report. We've talked about the work of Nordhaus and Rahmer. And is there any consolation there for Colleen?
I would think so. I don't have data to specifically answer the question, but what I can say is that currently everything that we have in terms of transitioning towards clean sources of energy does not demonstrate a lower standard of living. Actually, quite the contrary. Actually, the fact that we're moving towards more solar, more wind, hydroelectricity, even nuclear, which is actually a very clean source, actually the cleanest source of energy there is. These moves are not only cheaper than oil, because when you see the investments, take a country like China right now, China invests more in clean energy than in oil right now. And so the idea is that there's actually an argument to be made that there is a democratization of with clean tech there of the energy sources, and there's greater access to this technology around the world. So the overall standard of living is actually going to grow and is actually going to develop, and is going to be less in the hands of people who and countries that have access to oil and gas, and actually going to be, there's going to be a greater access to that technology. And the price of those technologies has actually been going steadily down. And so what we're seeing right now is, and Tom, you mentioned this as well, a lot of the major pension funds, investment funds are moving away from fossil fuels. And yes, there is a moral and ethical imperative, but it's also because there's money to be made in those new, cleaner sources of energy. And so the idea here that there's going to be a lower standard of living because we're leaving fossil fuels isn't right now being proven by the data. Now, the other piece is that there is, however, and that's where the question is, I feel very, very relevant, is the fact that there is an uncertainty with the transition. So when you have an economy that is based in fossil fuels, like, for example, Alberta, well, you are going to have an uncertainty there. So that's why, and any country like Canada, for example, who has an economy that is largely based on oil and gas, you're going to have to think about how you transition that economy away. So that means investments, because you can't just say, oh, we'll just go solar, wind, and hydro. You have to actually work on how you're going to invest in, for example, in carbon capture, how you're going to transition away from fossil fuels and develop these jobs and get these people that are working, that are depending on the oil and gas industry, to transition to jobs that are not dependent on those industries. So that's the challenge. But again, everything that we've seen so far in terms of technology and the work that Tom has referred to, for example, cap and trade system, carbon taxes, all these measures have also created much more investment in the development of these technologies, and the fact that maybe this is not going, we know actually this is not going fast enough, but it is heading in the right direction to create those clean sources of energy that can replace oil and gas.
Tremendous. Can I just jump in here?
Go ahead, please, Norman, go ahead.
I just want to add to what David said, which is all really good. I want to add that we need to also, as a community, as a nation, as a culture, have the discussion about what do we mean by standard of living? What are the metrics by which we judge these things? Because one of the things that ought to be very clear is that we are seeing that what we consider to be a high standard of life is usually equated with a high consumption level life. And I think we're seeing a lot of people who are walking away from that. Young people I know say they want nothing to do with the kind of lifestyle that their parents had, because they may have a lot of stuff, but they are miserable. And well, so we're having to ask the question, what is a meaningful life? What is a good life? What is a praiseworthy life? And this, I think, is something that faith communities, but not just faith communities, are ideally suited to do. They can have the conversation about, when are we living a good life? It doesn't have to mean a life of utter deprivation, but it doesn't also need to mean a life of high consumption.
Well said. Very, and it brings us full circle right back to the ethical and Christian component of our discussions tonight. Thank you very much for that, Norman. Ghassan asked me if I could mention something about young people in politics. It's interesting because we're always talking about the next generation, but often the people who are in politics are very long in the tooth. And I remember when we had a big breakthrough in the 2011 election, our youngest member of parliament was 19 years old, and we had 30 members of parliament under 30. And that was a real sea change. That was a lot of fun. And they were pushing exactly these issues. So I think that, you know, as people make their choices, seeing if you've got enough young people in your party helping formulate policy and giving you ideas for your choices as to what to put into place, that's really good. Is somebody want to take on the last part of Ghassan's question, please?
I think he directed it towards Jessica.
Okay.
Yes, great question. And I'll give a short answer is yes. Our churches have a really big role to play in this, both, as you mentioned, in how in our churches that we do consume and do our operations, from putting solar on our building, making our church congregations more energy efficient, and what kind of recycling and composting, other things that we buy within our church congregations. They have a big place to play. But I'll also add that I think in doing that, it has two additional benefits that aren't just related to carbon reductions, is that first, we have a lot of education that needs to happen in our churches. And a lot of churches are doing this really well, but there's still room to grow. And again, by putting some of those practices into place, it provides that natural opportunity to share the reason behind it and provide that education about the biblical basis of this, as well as how engaging in climate solutions is part of our mission, the mission of God. Engaging in the mission of God is serving others and making sure they have that healthy environment. And then secondly, with that, once folks begin to see that personal connection there, then I think it's a gateway towards that collective action too. And churches are just incredible organizing bodies. I always think about it of just, wow, watch out. If you get the church really motivated on a certain topic, things are going to change.
Well said. Well said. So, Meg, I think we can take another couple of questions, given the timing so far, and we'll try to keep things on track. It's been moving along a pace.
Sounds good. So I'll invite Tom and then Blair to ask your questions.
Thank you very much, Reverend Meg. Thank you to the panel. This is very informative. My question this evening is about, I think Dr. Caroline mentioned environmental innovation by large global private sector industry. And I'm quite intrigued by this, because it seems when the private sector embraces a cause or an issue, it seems to move much faster in terms of process time. I'm thinking specifically about the aviation industry with Airbus and Embraer and their quest to discover hydrogen-powered airplanes that cut down emissions. And I just wanted to get an opinion on that. Do you believe that these industries are sincere with their with their gestures and their policies and their innovation? And also, how, as a second part, how do you think that type of change and shift is going to affect the global supply chain?
All right, that's a big question, Blair.
Yeah, my question does have to do with global in part. I currently serve on faculty at a small theological college in Malawi, even though I live in Ottawa, and my wife Vivian now works for climate change or environment and climate change Canada, but previously served in Malawi doing some climate change adaptation projects. So I'm quite concerned about an ecclesiology that kind of ignores the fact that the church is bigger than Canada or the United States, and that we have brothers and sisters around the world who say that climate change is their number one issue. We live through a cyclone Idai. My colleagues will laugh when I would say that there are climate change deniers. They can point to the day when their farming changed because of climate change. And I know that there are many on this call who will want to take local action as well, but they also want to partner somehow or have a relationship with Christians who are not just in the global north, but who are in developing countries, who are in the global south. And I wonder if there's anything that we might be able to do to strengthen that and to encourage climate change action
conversations
in places and ways other than just within ourselves, in our largely middle class, upper middle class, northern reared enclave, and actually break out of that and talk to the billions of people who are going to sacrifice a great deal more than we ever will in climate change.
Well, that's a really big question. I know it is really suited to Caroline's expertise. I'm going to allow myself to talk very briefly to Tom's question about aviation. It's very specific, but it's a specific example that opens up into the larger conversation about getting something done. We know there's a problem there and we've got to be acting on it. I just took part a couple of weeks ago in a conference of the International Civil Aviation Organization, which has its headquarters, by the way, here in Montreal. And that was the key topic. That's what we were discussing. What is the future of aviation if we have to move over towards fuels that are not emitting the types of greenhouse gases that we got? We know that aviation is a huge emitter, and we've never been doing the science enough about where the emissions are taking place and how that affects the entire atmosphere because of what we're doing. I'm encouraged. You give the examples of Airbus and Embraer. I know that Airbus is really moving along a pace, and I'll pitch back to you a point that is implicit in a lot of what we've been saying tonight, because Tony Blair said this once, and it's always put a smile on my face. It's such a simple way to express a complex notion of using the instruments of public policy. But he said, you know, there are only two things. There's things that work and things that don't work. And so what we're doing now doesn't work. So we've got to start trying something else. And I think that the change is going to come in civil aviation, and we will have much cleaner aircraft than what we have right now. But I'd also say that there's a challenge for us. We've got to look it right in the face, because we're going to be told that this is developing a new era, that this is going to help with travel to other planets. Right now, three billionaires, Elon Musk, Richard Branson, and Jeff Bezos, are having fun building toys that can send aging actors and others to the edge of space and then back down. Now, if you do the numbers, they'll try to convince you that it's somehow magic, that there's nothing really happening there to be measured. But actually, if you run the numbers, the quantity of greenhouse gases per passenger is phenomenal. But it's also for no useful purpose. It's a carnival ride for millionaires built by billionaires. So that becomes an ethical question, which is at the essence of much of our discussion tonight. Is there a place for saying, no, you can't do that? No, we're already making a mess of enough of the planet, and you will not be allowed to do that. And then the question is, of course, who gets to say that? But I did find it particularly galling that the three of them decided that that was the best thing to do with several billion of their dollars, because it makes them feel good. And I think that enough said there. I don't know if anybody would like to take another shot at that, but I would love to turn to Carolyn now so she can take on some aspects of the very complex question that Blair was asking us.
Well, the thing is that There are different organizations that are working with sustainable farmers in developing countries and that. And there are links that are being made between farmers here and farmers in developing countries. There's a couple of different ones that are doing that already. But you have to be very careful. I mean, you know, development work is not really something that we maybe, I don't know if we want to look at as more as capacity building. And that in terms of, but and the impact on climate, it's to me, it's a very complicated situation because as I tell my students, yes, we can buy local, but if we only buy local, then we're also causing a lot of hardship in countries that export food and that they rely on us to buy those foods, to buy the mangoes, to buy the things that they're shipping out. And so if you say that you're only going to buy local, then it's going to have an impact there. And then they're probably going to not have enough money to make better decisions about climate because certain things do require money. And so this is I mean, I think I go back to, I think one of the original questions was about, you know, kind of paying your own way. I really think sometimes, like, it's clear that all the things that we do for food security, saving, you know, like going out and harvesting food and that, it's only partially effective. The best way to solve food security is to give people a living wage. And whether your government is paying that or not, that is the way to solve food security problems. Same way to solve food security and climate change issues in some of the developing countries. People cut corners because they can't afford to do anything else and they need to eat. But just to go back to the question, just the recent question, there was just an article or a short little news item that I believe it was in Germany. Somebody developed a tractor that was using methane produced from methane in cartridges that was produced from landfill. And there are electric tractors out there now. So all of this is coming from the private enterprises. They basically see that the consumers are demanding this. And it's the governments, again, we'll go back to that, that are falling behind. They are falling very, very far behind. And just to go back to the airplane issue, I think there's going to be a huge issues with COVID. The universities and people traveling now are questioning why they're traveling to conferences. So we're going to see huge changes with that because there's people now saying climate change, the cost of that airplane going to a conference, when it's just as easy to do it online like this. So that's going to have a huge impact.
We've all learned that. Thanks so much, Carolyn. Meg, unless you have something you would like to add, I would be ready to start to wrap. Oh, Norman wanted to add something. Please do.
No, I just wrote it in the chat. That's fine.
Yeah, so I will encourage, there was one question asked in the chat and Caroline very kindly responded in the chat. I'm impressed, Caroline, that you were typing and also listening to the other questions at the same time. The special skill. So there is a little bit of a conversation there about ethical transportation and how it's well and good to talk about public transportation in the cities. But it's a whole nother matter when you live out in rural areas where there is no connection. So that's interesting. And Norman added a little bit of extra about teaching in South Sudan. So that's good. So I encourage you to look at the chat. I just want to say, I know you're going to close us off, Tom, but I just want to say thank you to you and to all of our panelists for taking time out tonight and for sharing with us. It's been fascinating. It's wonderful to hear where your fields intersect and where you agree, but also where you kind of go in different directions and to hear the many different directions we can come at when we're thinking about the climate crisis. And thank you to all of those who are online. Our final session is tomorrow morning at 9:30. So I look forward to seeing you there. And I'll let Tom close us off.
Well, Meg, I think you just said it perfectly. So it's up to me now to say a heartfelt thank you to Norman, to David, to Jessica, to Carolyn, and to you. And to all the people who took part in this discussion after, it came from so many different directions, but it really allowed us to complete the thoughts that have been put out there. This is a great panel, and it was a great idea and an initiative of the Synod that I think is worthwhile, because it allows us to bring together the spiritual and the practical, the political, the scientific, and to realize that at the end of the day, this really is about respecting God's creation, and how we come at it can be very different. But if that is part of the ethic that is driving us forward, we can't go wrong. Thank you so much for inviting me to be part of it. I was honored. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you. Have a great night, everyone.
Thank you.